I would like to introduce our first speaker of the day for Arrows, aka Don Trent Jacobs. He is currently a professor at Fielding Graduate University. He's a prolific author with many, many books. How many? No.
Not as many as Bruce. 21 books.
He was selected by the Alternative Education Resource Organization as one of 27 visionaries in education. And in 2004, while a tenured professor at NAU, he received the Martin Springer Institute's Moral Courage Award for his pro-Indian activism. While Dean of Education at Oglala Lakota College, he fulfilled his Sundance vows with Rick Two Dogs Medicine Horse Group. He currently lives in Mexico, where he's working with local fishermen to create the first no-take zone on the Costa Alegre. And as you have noted and noticed, he's a wonderful leader in the issues that we are discussing. I approached him a couple years ago about organizing this conference, and he has done a marvelous job of bringing in marvelous speakers, many of whom are speaking today. So please welcome Four Arrows.
Mishante atawa wogala ke na pechu ze pelo. Oyate oyasi unchi wichalapo na oichakiapo. Hecho wichozani washte yoni wa pitelo. Oyate oyasi chanko luto och namani oichakiapo. Mihani lako wichanki tunkashi de kiksu. I'm saying in Lakota that my name is Four Arrows, and I offer everyone a warm handshake. And I'm here to bring health to all the people, to help us bring health to all the people, and to bring balance to all the people not being just the human people. And I want to remember the old Lakota ways, which have a lot in common with all of our indigenous worldview ways we're talking about. I'm going to play two songs. I don't know if you notice, but I'm wearing my IRA black beret, which was adopted in 1917 by the Fighting Irish, the IRA. It was actually the Irish Republican Brotherhood that became the Irish Republican Army. I'm a lot more Irish, actually, than I am Shalagi, than I am Indian. And so even though the Irish, who suffered very similarly to indigenous peoples, became the oppressors. I went and bought myself a Irish shirt here at this beautiful university. And I was told by Carlos Nakai many years ago that when I talk, I should always play both of my heritages. So I'm gonna play a little quick tribute to my Irish and then one to my Cherokee. I think you'll recognize this one. Next one I'm going to honor is a lullaby that was sung by the mothers to their children on the Trail of Tears. The words to the lullaby are about seeing the beauty in spite of all of the horrors that surround us. I think that's a good thing to remember.
I want to pass this, I guess I better bring a microphone.
Can you hear me through this? I'm going to pass this braided sweetgrass around, and I want everyone to just smell it so that we can bring some of the natural world into this room. And I wanted to end up with Dr. Robin Kimmerer back there, because I told her I would give her this in honor of her book, Braiding Sweetgrass. So if you just make sure it gets to her, make this come go to her last. There you go. Okay, so the presentation that I had planned on giving has been destroyed completely. Because after yesterday's amazing work by all of you, I thought there's a lot of little gaps that need to be filled. So last night I stayed up late and put together a PowerPoint. I always like to start with my horse because the horse energy is really an important one to me. So that's Shante. That's Shante, my horse in Mexico. And okay, so about me. If you want to see how non-Indian I am, that's little guy next to the Great Dane on the left. That's me with my Irish father. My Irish, I've never been to County Kildare, but our family comes from County Kildare. My father was Irish. Next to that, I have a picture of Roy Rogers and Trigger. Why is that? Mom, especially during some times when she was sipping the Seagram's VO, would speak in bittersweet ways about her Cherokee heritage, about the suicide of her dad, and was never very in positive or encouraging about it, and same thing with her sister. But I do remember that when I was this picture, I think I was in second grade, I was in Mrs. Bagwell's class, and Mom had forgotten my Roy Rogers lunchbox. And she didn't put on her makeup like she usually did to try to cover up her Indian features. I wish I had a picture of her. And when she walked into the room and set the Roy Rogers lunchbox on the back table, and she left, all the kids started chanting, "Donnie's mom's a squaw, Donnie's mom's a squaw." And I looked up at Mrs. Bagwell, and she kind of crossed her arms and smirked, and I began my cross-country running career as I ran back into the Missouri home that I lived in. So I lived with that, grew up in an urban place with no indigenous or Cherokee or any kind of affiliation beyond this sort of confusing, bittersweet relationship that I had with Mom and her relatives. And I joined the Marine Corps. And after Vietnam, I became a firefighter, and I wrote 10 books on physical fitness, health psychology, sports hypnosis, and got my degree in health psychology, my doctorate. But I had a chip on my shoulder after the Marine Corps, and I did a lot of whitewater kayaking on unknown rivers. So I went to Rio Urique in Mexico, and I went down the Rio Urique, and I had a near-death experience on the river. And the Rarotonga Indian people rescued me. This is the Cimarron people of the Tarahumara who live deep into the canyons. And so I actually I wrote a book on that. It was my dissertation for my second doctorate. Right after I got my doctorate in curriculum and instruction with a cognate and indigenous worldview, I became Dean of Education at Oglala Lakota College. I built a geodesic dome and brought my horses and my wife there, or my wife and my horses. I had to give the right priority. And I lived with the people, rode my horse to work, became a sun dancer, fulfilled my four Sundance vows with Rick Two Dogs. And the little slide over to the right is Treaty 4 Tribal Council in Canada, just one of many recognitions that I've got for my activism in behalf of Indigenous people. I put that little, I'm glad I did it, but I put a little dollar sign next to my Primal Awareness book because I just wanted to let you know, of all the 22 books that I've written, all the proceeds that I make from it all go to Indigenous charities. Rebecca Adamson's First Peoples Worldwide, the Sierra Madre Alliance, the Lakota peoples, etc. I think that's real important in light of some of the things that we've talked about in terms of identity. But that all said, I'm probably a wannabe. You know, and it's a controversial topic, and I understand and respect Phil Deloria's work on it. But I just wanted to bring that up because, you know, I don't really have a lot of of history or claims beyond what my personal family was. I don't have any. We've searched the rolls and cannot find our names. So I'm like many, many people, you know, the joke about everybody's got a Cherokee princess, even though there are no Cherokee princesses. So I guess I'm a wannabe, and I kind of want to give a statement that I hope everybody becomes a wannabe that's not Indian. Do you understand what I mean by that? Not in the derogatory terms of how wannabe is put forward, where it's, you know, people that are taking advantage and misappropriating, but we all are indigenous to this planet, and I think we're at a time and a place where the gatekeepers of who is Indian and who is not Indian, we need to start looking at that more respectfully, more carefully. I have a picture of Vine Deloria Jr. on the left and Ed McGaw, Eagle Man, on the right. Both of were friends of mine. Vine published one of his last chapters in one of my books. And in one of my books, I write about how Ed denigrates Vine as not being Indian enough. Okay, and this is, you know, Eagle Man's 20, you know, fellow Marine officer, 26 combat missions, many Sundances. And at the same time, Ed is criticized for being New Age because of some of his books. So even with these two incredibly amazing men, Lakota, who have done much, I think, for indigenous peoples, we still have this sort of territorialism about who is Indian and who's not Indian. And I think we've got to stop that. So I wanted to get that in. Our elders always judge people by their hearts and their minds. And just as I was made a relative by the Lakota, our elders, I know no Cherokee. You know, I've got my Cherokee students, my Cherokee sisters, but it's my own blood and I'm lost to it. So, you know, the Lakota is my pathway and I have no Lakota blood. So our elders always did judge people by their hearts and minds. And this is a quote from a research participant when asked what he thought about wannabes. And so where I live in a little palapa in Mexico. On the top right, you can see my backyard. And this is my lovely wife and my four animals. And that'll just give you a sense about who I am. The bottom line that I want to say is we are all humans. This is a picture of Sedona, Arizona, where beautiful spiritual place and a lot of trails. And you know, one day I was taking some couple that came to get spirituality for a weekend in Sedona. And I took them on this trail. And I was telling them, they wanted to know about, well, the American Indian is very spiritual. The American Indian is, you know, very magically spiritual. And I started to kind of respond to that when we came upon him. There was an American Indian laying on the middle of the trail on his side with his ear to the ground. And I said, just wait a minute. You'll see, maybe you'll get to meet one. And then he looked up at us and I said, so what are you listening to? He said, red Jeep, blonde woman, maybe in her 30s, sitting on the right side, man with a mustache sitting on the left side, German Shepherd in the back. And this couple that had come for spiritualities, blown away. They got just what they wanted. And I said, well, you okay? He says, yeah, they just ran over me. So we can make fun of that a little bit, and we can be, we can have my perspective on what I talked about with this idea of gatekeepers of the wannabes. On the other hand, in Sedona, this is a sweat lodge, and I don't like to use that term, but in this case, I'm going to use that term. This was a sweat lodge that people paid how much money? $9,965 for a three-day spiritual retreat, and three people died. You all know about this? Okay? And so that's also in Sedona. To show you that this is a complex topic. Okay, now let's get to my presentation. It's really interesting that when we were involved with the title of this, we really had a lot of discussions, some of them a little bit heated about it. And I found my notes. And so this was my notes, and I thought, you know what, it says a lot from what I learned yesterday, and I'm gonna copy what the ideas were. So you know, the title of our that we came up with was Sustainable Wisdom, Integrating Indigenous Knowhow for Global Flourishing. Okay. What I had wrote down was sustainable psychology, reclaiming, and I had spirituality, and then I scratched it out. Reclaiming worldview for rebuilding so as to move from a pathology to global flourishing. I think there's something in that we should be talking about. I also, I never mentioned this to anyone, but I also put remembering who we are might be a good topic as well. But I really am at the place where I think, based on Bruce's presentation, that this work that we're doing now is probably not going to help us with prevention, but it's certainly going to help us with whomever's going to be rebuilding. That's, I don't know if that's a pessimistic or an optimistic viewpoint. All right, but the topic I was given to do was Indigenous spirituality, and that's under the theme of becoming virtuous people. So I want to stay on task, boss. But, you know, the Ontario Human Resource Commission says that, you know, they won't define spirituality, Indigenous spirituality. And I tend to agree with that, in recognition of the great diversity that it has, okay? And to defend the rights of people to define their own spirituality. So, you know, because like, which tradition are we gonna take? Which spiritual tradition? They're all so unique. They're all so varied. And notice at the bottom right, I included Christianity. Now, just real briefly, I just want to speak critically, because I'm a critical theorist, about where I have the most incredible host. I'm spoiled for conferences. And I was so impressed that the president of this university sent such beautiful sentiments at the opening ceremony. And under this president who has done more for diversity than any president, you know, I want to be really respectful. But I think we also have to be critical of what's in the woodwork. And just walking down this morning, it was my first trip in the hallway, I saw this sign, let us rise up and embrace the challenge for our time. And then I walked a little bit further to build a bigger building at Notre Dame. Now, it's innocuous, it's innocent, and you know, that's probably, there was a campaign going on. But I thought of that in the context of the mural that Brian showed us that was celebrating Columbus in another building here. That there's all these celebrations of Columbus with indigenous people at his feet, kissing his feet, and even though some of the local students had protested and they had made a brochure about it, the brochure is not available, and how many people continue to learn the hegemony? So I've written a peer-reviewed article in UBC called False Doctrine, quoting Thomas Paine, and it's about Christianity and the stifling of indigenous political will. And I just wanted to know that should be on the table, even though we're an incredible university. It's a complex idea. So moving on, continuing with the OHRC's idea, they do also, when they say that we're not going to define spirituality, they do agree with that there are common themes that are such as place-based, nature is all, animistic, generosity-oriented, gift economies, non-hierarchical, cooperative, complementarity, those kinds of things. And so, you know, that would be the direction that I would want to go, is the generality about spirituality. But that's dismissed by many. This cartoon is looking at a sacred mountain, and they say, "Hi, you call that sacred?" I almost got fired at NAU because the Navajo were protesting, and I was protesting with them because they wanted to put recycled urine on the mountain, the sacred San Francisco Peaks. And the president of the university, going back to the university and what's in the woodwork, had just written a vision statement saying that they would honor the grounds on which the Navajo and the Apache and the Hopi and 12 other tribes were. And when we came to him to ask for him to take our side, he refused and took the side of the corporation. And so I went on the radio and challenged him. But we've got to be critical about the hegemony and the word power that surrounds us everywhere. Even academics, I don't know if you know, Houston Smith was the foremost religious expert. And for his entire career at the university, he never mentioned indigenous spirituality. Afterwards, he apologized profusely, and now he's devoted his life to looking at that. And this is just one of his retirement books, right? All right, so spirituality. Now, I guess I'm going to need a pointer to do this. Is there a pointer on this thing?
It's on there.
Is it? Would you, here, just point. There. Okay. Just write that little guy. See, can you click it, or how do you make it go on, I wonder? Oh, okay. Well, don't worry about it.
He can do it up there.
Okay. Oh, great. Hey. This is a class act, isn't it? Class act. All right, go ahead and press it.
It is an inclusive consciousness. That is, there is not enough sense of inclusiveness in human beings to use what we have towards solutions. So the greatest thing and the most important thing that needs to happen in this generation right now is, technology-wise, we're hugely enabled, we have the resource, we have the capability. Only thing is, a conscious will has not come. A conscious will has not come because an inclusive consciousness is missing.
Okay, thank you. So, inclusive consciousness. Well, now we're getting more into the worldview that we've been talking about yesterday, okay? Because consciousness is ultimately worldview. In fact, the Institute of Noetic Sciences, founded by Edgar Mitchell, who has also written about, he says, only a handful of visionaries understand that the indigenous worldview will get us through the problems that we have facing us. This is a quote before he passed on. And he has a program going on called Worldview Transformation. And ultimately, this consciousness that we're talking about can be correlated with the idea of worldview. Although I hate that word, frankly. I use it all the time now. It's a European word that the indigenous people do not see as a primary way of understanding the world. It rejects the cosmology and the emotion and the heart. But as an academic, it's the closest thing we have to being able to talk about what it is we've been talking about. And the definitions of worldview that are coming out from scholars, these are from the dissertation of Annick DeWitt, which is all about worldviews. And she says, worldview is a concept whose time has come. Okay. And Colto Rivera's famous article, The Psychology of Worldviews, is supporting it, right? Probably more controversial is Robert Redfield's work that says there's really only essentially two worldviews, whereas a number of scholars think that every belief is a worldview, that everybody in this room has a worldview. He says, no, based on those two definitions, there's something much deeper, something that we're unconscious of. And this is an idea that I believe in, and I believe it's very utilitarian for our work. Of course, even about worldview, there are many controversial claims. This is a book that I wrote back in 2006 at the University of Texas published, that a number of people in this room have chapters in. It's about anti-Indianism in America and the numbers of scholars that are looking and saying and working toward dismissing indigenous worldview. So at this point in time, I'm going to make the assumptions, and I'm going to try to go fast because I really want some feedback, and I know there'll be some questions about, well, how do we if we understand the indigenous worldview that is the common denominator to the great diversity of spiritual traditions, and we understand the same dominant worldview and indigenous worldview conflict with all the diversity under each, how do we actually move in that direction? That question was asked a number of times yesterday. Well, I would like to end now with these pictures, because what I've learned over the years, and what I learned when I lived with the Tarahumara, when I lived with the Seri, when I lived with the Lakota, when I lived with the Navajo, ultimately, all you gotta do is be who you are and be open to the teachers that surround us in nature. Now, the argument is, well, but most people live in concrete and glass in cities. Well, nature is still there. That's why I put the fly in. And I used to do this all the time, but we don't have time. I would have everybody go outside right now to the trees next to us. And I'd ask you all to go, just touch a tree and come back. And then I'd have to get up and go out again and say, this time I want you to touch the tree, but I want you to ask permission first. And you're gonna laugh, I want you to wait for an answer. I've done this all over the world, and when people come back, it's unbelievable how it changes them and what they say about the communication. So that to me is the answer to this question that we're talking about, is, and this change of consciousness that the guru talked about. All right, so I wanna end with a way to get us motivated to do that. Something that has not been talked about in the conference, it's very rarely talked about in the literature. I'm gonna do a little promotion on Darsha and my chapter, and this is Ewain Ross, an author of many social studies textbooks. He just put a new social studies textbook that will be used throughout high schools in Canada. And he invited Darcy and I to write a chapter in it on Indigenous worldview, in which we present a number of things, including the idea of what I refer to as the cat-fawn connection. Now, I did my first dissertation on the cat-fawn, or my second dissertation on the cat-fawn dissertation, and when my chair brought it back to me, it said, this is either brilliant or it's bullshit. And I was dismayed. It took him about 10 years to finally say that, well, okay, maybe it wasn't bullshit. But cat represented a mountain lion that I saw in the, well, you know what, I'm not gonna tell you that story, but there were two animals, a fawn and a cat, that right after my near-death experience on the Rio Uric, I saw. And I had a vision that these two animals turned into letters. And the letters were C-A-T-F-A-W-N. So it's really a mnemonic for a metacognitive worldview reflection strategy that, if we get it, the experience that I've had with it over the years shows that it's truly transformative and can bring people to where we're hoping people can move to help rebuild. CAT stands for Concentration Activated Transformation. What that means is that we are literally constantly being hypnotized. We don't talk about hypnosis, okay? Most of the religions say it's something of the devil. And yet it's all animal. I learned it from wild horses. And I talk about that in primal awareness. All animals are subject to this phenomenon, and we are too, for better or for worse. And it's time for us to take control of it. It's time for us to understand that our indigenous ancestors, they knew this without knowing the terminology or the technology or the words of brainwave frequencies or trance or whatever. But the healing, the hunting, the practicing of virtues, all of those things were done going into trance states, alternative awareness, change of brainwave frequency from beta to alpha or theta. chanting, dancing, singing, vision quests, on and on and on and on and on, sometimes plant medicine, okay? And so if we can remember that self-hypnosis is happening all the time, what we say to ourselves, what our early childhood memories are programmed to tell us, okay? You come up to a little six-year-old that's writing and can't write well, and a big, strong teacher comes up and says, "Oh, Johnny, you're never going to amount to anything. That's going to last for a lifetime." Okay? Why? These are hypnotic. This is the way our brains are programmed. Okay? But we're supposed to know how to handle it and how to know when someone else is doing it to us. And that's why I mentioned the things at the universities that are on the woodwork. You know, we need to understand that words are powerful. Okay? And that's why indigenous cultures saw them as sacred. Greg Cahete and I wrote a book together called Critical Neurophilosophy. We didn't start out that way. We started out, we wanted to show how neuroscience supported indigenous wisdom until we had our doctoral students do the studies that came out saying deception is a natural survival mechanism. Generosity doesn't exist because there's a little part of the brain that when people give monopoly money away is the same place where we see that selfishness happens, you know? So they conclude, but what are they really doing? Because even an MRI machine cannot see all the way down into the depths of the human brain. What they're really doing is seeing through the worldview of the dominant culture, okay? And so we can avoid the negative and we can program, if you will, the positive. So this propaganda, the indirect hypnosis, the direct hypnosis, the intentional, unintentional, when we believe an idea or an image, trance logic overshadows both reason and deep knowing. How else do you explain what we're doing to our planet? How do you explain it if you don't look at this phenomenon that the literature would call hypnosis? How do you explain it otherwise that we do such insane things? Okay, I've got the heart of everything that is, because here's a book that was touted as the most honest reflection on indigenous Lakota history ever done by the New York Times, the San Francisco Chronicle. I picked it up. It was full of anti-Indianism. So if you go on to Truth Out and put in the heart of everything that isn't and read my article, you'll see why this is continuing on and on. Okay? So, in fact, you know, we had a little conversation about boarding schools yesterday, and I went in and I, you know, got the Canadian Truth and Reconciliation report, and you know, it's about physical, biological, and cultural genocide, and the cruelty and the percentages of people, all the things that I mentioned yesterday, you know. We've got to know that, but most people don't know it. Most people don't know it, and if they do know it, they don't talk about it. And if they do hear about it, they often go into denial about it, right? So I've got the report up here on another slide, but we're not gonna have time to show it, but I can show it to anyone who wants to come over and see it. It's not easy to read, not easy to read. I have Will Rogers, a Cherokee cousin, in the picture, because he really speaks to the phenomenon of hegemony when he says, "It ain't what we don't know that hurts us, it's what we know that ain't true." Okay, what are the four forces that really influence, concentration-activated transformation, that really influence this hypnotic receptivity that we all have that we're not really in control of because we think our cognitive minds can do it all for us? Well, the four basic ones that came to me in the vision have to do with fear, authority, words, and nature. FAWN standing for FAWN. The Tauromara, the fawn, was a baby fawn that was over the shoulders of a Tauromara person. And the feet were bleeding. The Tauromara actually ran it down. And, you know, and we were talking about Indian running, right? And it was just quite amazing. But anyway, okay, so in real brief, so that we'll have lots of time for talking. And this is going to be really brief. Fear, and also generalizing. In the dominant culture, the main approach to fear is avoidance. We don't like fear. And when we are afraid, it's very common not to take a stand, to avoid, to go into denial, all the defense mechanisms to keep us from engaging fear. There's study after study after study that shows that there are great exceptions to this, because remember, worldview can cross boundaries. But this is the predominant phenomenon under the dominant worldview. Under the indigenous worldview, I contend that fear is seen for people who can still hold. Remember, a lot of our indigenous people no longer hold the indigenous worldview. But for people who do, they see fear as an opportunity to practice a virtue. So I'm afraid, okay, grandmother bear is in front of me and she's about to eat me. I got my berries. Well, let's see, what virtue have I been working on? Patience, fortitude, courage, generosity. Yeah, generosity, I haven't been so good at generosity. Wow, okay, this is the ultimate opportunity for generosity. Grandmother bear, there's my berries. If you want them, I give them to you, but if for some reason you need protein, I give myself to you. A bear leaves you alone, probably, okay? But it's an opportunity to practice a virtue. Moreover, courage is such an important value in indigenous cultures for so many reasons. But courage moves into fearlessness in indigenous worldview when you take action. The only person in Western societies that I've found that doesn't say fearlessness is foolish, I'm talking about, you know, all the philosophers. Let's go back to the founding of Western philosophy, the founding father. Who is that? Socrates. Okay. And Plato gives Socrates the words, I'm not going to learn anything out amongst the trees. I can only learn amongst the people. Right? So we wonder how the dominant worldview is so anthropocentric. It's been supported by the philosophies that we engage. Well, he also said, to be fearless in battle is foolish. Indigenous ideas about this have to do with trusting the universe. Okay, I'm going to get the courage. But let's say that you get enough courage to take a strong stand. And then you have to hold on to that courage while you take action and you do the work. And then whether you're successful or not, it's done. You're exhausted. The next time you have to be courageous, you know, you're going to have to think twice about it. Even if you were successful, you're going to go, wow, that took a lot of energy. That was stressful. But the indigenous people that I've lived with, who, like the Cimarron people, who have not embraced any of the Western cultures, deep in the 8,000 feet down in Copper Canyon, and I'm being abbreviated here, but once they take action, and just like everybody else, it requires, they got to get the courage, and that comes from how much they believe in all of this, right? And then it goes into the hypnotic phenomenon of believing in what they can do. But once they commit to the action, whatever it is, they trust the universe. They trust the spirits. And whatever the outcome is, that fearlessness takes away the pain of the emotion of fear and courage. Authority. We know in the dominant culture, hierarchy is the main thing. I heard someone in the conference yesterday saying something about, how can you have a non-hierarchical corporation? You wouldn't get anything done. You know, is there any models for that? And somebody that was talking to them said, well, yeah, there are models, right? We have a hierarchical system of authority. The teacher, the preacher, the father, and that, please know this, I wrote a book on hypnosis that Prentice Hall published, called Patient Communication for First Responders. Do you know that if you all leave here today and, you know, I hope this doesn't happen. You come upon an automobile accident, and someone's inside and they're bleeding, and you can't get to them, and say it's Darsha. Darsha could go up to that window and speak with her authority and say, listen, I'm a doctor at Notre Dame, and I've called the ambulance. It's on its way. The worst is over. Things are being made ready for you at the hospital, but you're hemorrhaging. I can't open the door. It's crushed. The firefighters will be here soon, but you need to stop your bleeding. So when I count to three, I want you to stop your bleeding. Okay, you ready? One, two, three. Do you know 90% of the time that person in a state of spontaneous hypnosis, the bleeding will stop, he'll save their life. Because, as with wild horses, during times of stress, all creatures become hypersuggestible to the signals of a perceived trusted authority figure. Guess how? Who else knew that? Goebbels, under Hitler. He said, I can get any country to do anything under any form of government. All I got to do is make them afraid and be the authority to tell them what to do. So you can see how these things all interact. They're all interrelated. If we have fear and there's an authority person and they tell us what to do, this is why so many people are afraid of Donald Trump, probably. Words. In the indigenous culture, you know, Tom wrote a great book called A Time Before Deception. It's really true that integrity and words were powerful sacred forces. And the idea of lying, he writes, when the Europeans first lied, we thought it was a mental illness. And we had pity for them because they couldn't see and understand reality, okay? Words today, right, are used for deception. And like I was saying, the book that Greg and I wrote, was one of the things that even the neuroscientists are saying, right? So we've got to look at our words that we say to ourselves. I can give you so many examples of self-talk that we give. I taught hypnosis at UC Berkeley in the psychology department. And I had a sports psychology practice. In fact, I have a person in the Olympics from Brazil who placed fifth in fencing, who brought me out of retirement, Natalie Molhausen. But I had a guy call me, he was an executive from San Francisco, and he had a sweat problem. He would sweat right before he goes into a meeting. And I said, what do you say to yourself before you go into the meeting? He says, well, I look at the watch and I say, I have to be on time. I said, okay, I'll have my secretary make an appointment for you, but this is what I want you to do in the meantime. Next time you look at your watch, don't say, I have to be on time, or I must be on time. Say, I want to be on time. And he went, yeah, whatever. He called me back the next day and he went, did you hypnotize me on the phone? No, I didn't. He had been self-hypnotizing himself, and by changing that, he took the stress away. That's how powerful words are. And finally, nature. Nature. We don't need to talk much about that, do we? The indigenous perspective versus the perspective. So I just want to say that how we can bring this into the world is by being who we are, who we really are. And we can borrow from indigenous cultures. In my book, Teaching Truly, I do a whole chapter which is all about how to teach non-Indian people, if you're a non-Indian teacher, indigenous ways. A slippery slope, right? Some of my brothers say, whoa, you shouldn't be teaching that. Others say, hey, thanks for teaching that. But we can borrow. We can borrow from this incredible prayer and relate it to our own locality. We've got to relearn our indigeneity and rebuild our ceremonies in our own way after we take care of the indigenous cultures that are existing and we stop killing them and we support them. Because those who are in our area, like the beautiful ceremony we hit, they have knowledge that we're not going to ever, in many lifetimes, be able to gain. And so if we don't do this both and again, you know, no matter where we are, and try to do that, and at least, you know, don't continue the genocide, we can borrow a prayer like this. And and relate it to the life that surrounds our locale. So just remember who you are and who you can be by listening to our visible and invisible teachers. You know, even when nature isn't near, you can find it. And if you see them as teachers, and that's a worldview shift. It's a real worldview shift. Took me a long time to do it, you know. Mosquito comes in, you slap it. You go back to typing. You go, oh, shit. I forgot, right? Doesn't mean you can't ultimately kill it. It means that there's got to be this relationship. There's got to be this respect. You've got to make sure, is it the right thing to do? I can't tell you how many hours it takes me to get a mosquito out of my office sometimes. So, not many of us in the dominant culture would really understand what Black Elk said here. But I think that's the bottom line. Birds build their nests in circles, for theirs is the same religion as ours. Analyze that, Rick Two Dogs, my Sundance leader would say. Thank you. Now, by the way, I want you to notice that I'm wearing an Irish fighting, right, shirt, and I'm wearing, in 1917, the IRA wore the black beret, and I wore that to really honor this beautiful host and hostess that we have here. Thank you. Okay, questions?
Thank you. Thank you so much, Foreros, for your wisdom. You've really honored your ancestors and ours.
Thank you. So, yes.
Thank you, Foreros. A practical question. So I'm a middle-aged, bald, white guy. And, you know, it's just painful knowing the legacy that my guys brought to this continent, okay? And it's painful to be even in a setting like this among friends, just knowing that. And there's a tension. What we're basically saying is the world needs the indigenous worldview. And of all people, white guys in this nation with power need this. But as a white guy, when you go out and try to find good teaching, it's not easy. I've done my best, teachers on Pine Ridge and in South America and Europe and so on, but I'm always feel like I'm looking over my shoulder for the native person who's going to accuse me of being a plastic shaman, et cetera, et cetera. And I understand that too. And that stupid story of the sweat lodge and that man who, you know, that's terrible. So.
I hear you.
You hear what I'm saying.
I totally hear.
What's your wisdom on that?
That's why I brought the wannabe phenomenon on the table. I hear this all the time, okay? And I told this story to someone the other day. I think when David and I were talking, I can't remember when. But anyway, I'm 70, so I'm forgetting a lot. So my wife tells me. My wife and I were playing music. I played blues and jazz at the Star School, Service to All Relationships, Navajo school Mark Sorensen runs, when I lived in Flagstaff, Arizona. And at the end of the songs, I were playing, you know, Black and Blue and, you know, St. James Infirmary blues and stuff like that. I played the thank you song from the Mayanipi ceremony. Oh man, right away, one of the medicine men came up to me that I know and he said, hey, you know better than to take that out of this circle. And I respectfully disagreed with him. And another guy came up, it was another respectful, highly respected medicine man, and he went, thank you for taking that out of the circle. So the answer to the question is, you've got to realize that Indigenous people have the right, based on the history, to have this kind of defensiveness. Of everything's been taken away, everything. And now people want to dress up Indian, and they want to do this, they want to do this, and charge money and kill people, right? So you got to understand that and have empathy for it. And at the same time, I know a lot of full-blood, quote, because probably are none, who are more white than any white person I know. And so what you've got to do is just have the courage and do the visualization. You know, I don't know, it's so simple. You know, this seems like you can get yourself a paper clip and a piece of dental floss. We did this to help Greg Cahetty with his jet lag yesterday. To know if you're in self-hypnosis and save yourself from paying $300 for somebody like me to hypnotize you, just take it, this paper clip or whatever you got. I can use my necklace. And first move it in a circle with your fingers so you see what it looks like. Now you got the image, because all hypnosis is believing in an image. Now believe in that image. Now watch what happens.
Just real quick. You see it start to go? Bigger and bigger?
All right, the reason that happened is simply idiomotor neurons. Edmund Jacobs in 1939 showed that right before you do an action, when you imagine it and believe in it, the ideomotor neurons fire. And that's sufficient to move it. But what it does indicate is you've shifted into an alternative brainwave frequency that allows you to take a hypnotic directive or suggestion and actually make it become a reality also. So if you can keep it going, sort of like patting your head and rubbing your stomach, if you can keep it going and then say, I want to have more courage and not worry about the guy over my shoulder, and phrase it positively, right? Don't say, I'm not going to hit the ball in the sand trap, or hit it in the sand trap. You understand what I'm saying? Anyway, okay. Yeah.
I'd like to go to points on your dominant worldview versus indigenous worldview. One of the potential problems, it seems to me, is your or, you know, what is it, what are things from the dominant worldview worth having? For example, I've had a love-hate relationship with Socrates for a long time. He's been a great teacher for me. Yes, he said he only learns from people in the city. On the other hand, in the Phaedrus, he goes out under a tree and has a discussion with a student, at the end of which he gives thanks to this place, Pan. Who is an anthropomorphic form, still the representative of nature. So there's both there. On the other hand, he may say what you said about fearlessness, but we know Alcibiades in the Symposium gives an account where in battle he was wounded, and Socrates went over and picked him up, and they were retreating from the enemy, and the enemy was slaughtering whoever was left. And he said Socrates gave him a fierce look, gave the enemy a fierce look, and none of them came near him.
Right.
He was practicing fearlessness no matter what he said. One other point, I had a day 10 years ago where I had a lot of time with two wives of Carl Sagan and Neil deGrasse Tyson for whatever reasons. And at this reception, I found myself talking with Neil deGrasse Tyson, and I thought I'd have some fun. I said, you know, I'm actually a part-time geocentrist. And he said, how can you say that? You can't say that. That's not scientific. I said, no, I have no problem with the science. I know the Earth goes around the sun. I just happened to find that at dawn and sunset, everything in my body just calls out sunrise or sunset. And apparently it does for the birds and the creatures who are having this experience as well. So I find experientially, it's right for me, maybe even scientific experientially, I don't need the larger scientific view for practical experience. And yet, I like it. I can go there. And so it seems to me there are elements that are undeniable from the precision of science. You don't have to live with them all the time. So how does that, how do these elements?
I totally understand. We've had this conversation. It's a slippery slope in this way. And David and I have had this conversation. In the indigenous worldview, one of the vastly important ideas is the seeking of complementarity. The seeking of complementarity. I mean, I write about this in a lot of places from different cultures where it's like, I can't remember the name of the tribe, an African tribe, where they say everything, well, almost everything has complementarity, is how they say it. Everything, well, almost everything has complementarity, but you've got to look for it, okay? You know, even Darwin, on page 8 in Descent of Man said, I'm going to talk about competition and species selection, but really the world is a cooperative system, right? You know, and then it wasn't until mutual aid came out, right? But most people took the other part of it. So I'm often accused of, well, how can you do this duality when you're promoting complementarity, okay? We're talking about the deep worldview. Either we are a part of nature or we're superior to nature. There are some either ors that have aspects to them that we can find complementarity in. At the same time, there are philosophies and written things in every culture, in every religious tradition that speak from the kind of worldview that we're trying to say to each other and to the world we need to do to survive. So it doesn't dismiss those kinds of things. And the reason that we're not doing the spirituality thing is because some people resonate with this particular idea from this particular philosopher or guru or religious tradition and not this one, right? That's why we let that happen. So the answer in a nutshell is keep seeking the complementarity. Don't think of it as a duality, but look at what is the unconscious belief systems that you have, and how do they make sense in terms of what we've been talking about? Okay. Yep. Okay. We have to stop. Thank you very much, everybody.